Welcome, President Battulga.
Thank you.
You've been the president of Mongolia since 2017, but it's been a long journey. You were a wrestler. You come from a home which was not either politically connected or very wealthy, and you worked your way up. You made a lot of money in business. You went through privatization. Before that, in fact, you even went into stitching of jeans. You went into the lottery business, the hotel business, real estate, taxis. And eventually, after being successful, you decided, okay, politics is right, and you moved into politics. What drove you to politics? And today that you're there, right at the top, how do you want to build relations with other countries around the world to try and reform the economy of Mongolia?
Thank you very much, and it is my pleasure to be visiting India with the invitation of the President of India, Mr. Kovind. And I'm very pleased to give an interview today. My first experience with the outside of Mongolia was during the early 80s, which was when I was a sportsman. And during that time, Mongolia was a socialist regime country. Therefore, it was rather closed than the other countries. And my success in sports enabled me to walk aboard the border and to see the world outside. And during the 90s, the former socialist countries have transitioned to democracy to establish a country with democracy and respect for human rights. And at that time, only the sportsmen, the successful sportsmen, and the ministers held passports, which enabled them to travel abroad. And with that passport, I, along with my colleagues and my friends, I traveled outside and I did business.
So did that actually help you, that widen your horizon? And today, as president, you probably have more knowledge than your contemporaries when it comes to the world at large.
Yes, and
to further elaborate on that, I would like I am telling you a short brief history of what Mongolia was like and how it helped me. For example, at that time, beginning of the 1990s, the Mongolia had only 2 million population was only 2 million, and the market economy, transition to the market economy was quite tough, very tough. For example, if you tell it like this, you would have left us to drown in the big sea of water. And at that market economy came with the transition to market economy came challenges, and with that the businessmen had struggled through that. And with our experience from those, I entered to the politics, and today I am elected as the president of Mongolia, and I have been president for about two years and 2 months now, same as your president. So my life story is only an example of one Mongolian person. So with this experience, I'm trying to make a better world for Mongolians and for the prosperity of Mongolia.
And one of the things you want to do is to try and use the resources of Mongolia, that is your raw materials, and invite overseas investment to create finished goods, because your exporting of raw materials does not bring you the type of revenue that you would like to see.
By reaching all the expectations of developing countries to become developed countries, we need to aim and reach all those achievements and expectations from us. So these are all including the processing facilities, investment, foreign investment. And therefore, trust is the most important asset for the investors and to attract investors. And during during my tenure as the last 2 years, I am paying visits to our neighbors as well as strategic partner countries and to the countries who have advanced technologies in processing.
With India, what is on the agenda? What exactly are you looking to do with India now?
For Mongolia and India, we have long history. Therefore, it's not about relation of knowing to getting to know each other. And Mongolia ratified its constitution back in 1992, and which enabled us to elect our first ever democratic president. And our first president's visit, first visit was to India, and I was one of the business delegation during that visit. At that time, we only talked about investment of $2 million only. And if you look back at that time, $2 million was considered to be a huge sum of money. But looking back, I sometimes think that we could have asked for more. And 10 years ago, the last previous visit of the President of Mongolia to India was in back in 2009, who was our fourth president. And at that time, we had on the agenda, we had the matter of $20 million. And during the visit of the Prime Minister Narendra Modi in May of 2015, we talked about the soft loan. There was a proposal of $1 billion of soft loan to Mongolia. The reason that I'm pointing out all these numbers is that to show you that looking back and for today, the Mongolia and India bilateral relations are progressing dramatically. So the numbers are even showing this. During my visit today to India, I have project proposals for cooperation in the fields of business, culture, sports, and youth. For example, the $1 billion soft loan to Mongolia for the construction of oil refinery was a very brave step from the Indian side. And this project is being implemented, and it is at the moment Mongolia has almost concluded the infrastructure, including the electricity, road, and the railroad, and all the progress at this point is 95%.
Most of Indian business, in fact, happens in the private sector. How are you planning to work with the Indian private sector? Because I do know that you would like to keep Mongolia not as open as other countries, perhaps in the West, are. You don't want immigration. You don't want people to come and settle there. But yet you want the business. So how do you balance this out?
As I've said before, I am one of the pioneers of Mongolian private sectors back in the days and still today. So I know the difficulties, I know the challenges, and I have overcome them. And I know that the key to development is business. For Mongolia, in terms of geography, Mongolia is landlocked and sandwiched between Russia and China, which may seem a closed country. And our aim to have access to the sea is being realized step by step. And during during our visit with the Prime Minister, we had discussions on this as well, in this matter as well. For example, Mongolia has signed access to the Russian ports with a concessional tariff of 25 years, and this agreement was signed a year ago in 2018, which is one of our realization of our access to the sea. And on the other hand, my recent visit to the U.S. We had an active talks with our American counterpart on the passing of the Mongolian Trade Act through the Congress, which will enable to export Mongolian textiles with customs free. So these are the steps, one of the steps that we are taking to support the Mongolian private sectors to the global and international markets, as well as boosting the investment to Mongolia. It has been only 29 years since our transition to market economy. I believe that I understand that we have overcome the challenges that we face during transition. But alongside with that, by solving all these issues we had, we are facing with new challenges. That is corruption. Today, we have a big group of corrupt people who are serving in the public services and who have been feeding off of it. Back in 1992, when we ratified our first democratic constitution, we didn't foresee this issue. At the moment, one of our biggest challenges is earning the trust of our foreign investors. With the mining boom and the businesses, all these revenues derived from the mining boom are being used in the very wrong hands in the terms of corruption. So we're trying to overcome this challenge, and we're trying to gain the trust again from our foreign investors. And one of my key promises to the people, the work of actions as President of Mongolia, was to fight the corruption, and I'm trying my best to. And my appeal to the Indian business and the Mongolian business is that we have so much opportunity to cooperate in the fields of industry, mining, agriculture, and tourism with Mongolia.
You made a lot of money in the period of privatization. So obviously you understand markets very well, apart from politics, of course. Now, I'm asking you as a businessman, so not just as a president, but as a businessman, when you come to India and you look at the Indian market, where do you see the opportunities between India and Mongolia? So where is it that you would put your money if you were not the president and rather you were still a businessman?
During the privatization period of Mongolia, there was a lack of cash, hard cash. So it is, again, back in history if you look back. But if I was a businessman and if I didn't go into politics, I'd be more focused on the tourism. It is an ambitious planet. Back in the day, I have experience in this. And during the early 2000s, I was... I directed some business in this area, and which is the religious tourism to connect Mongolia and India. And if I did not go into politics, I would see myself as a CEO of a large tourism company, which operates tourism between Mongolia and India.
I'm going to move now a little bit into your past and your sports. You, in fact, won the World Cup in wrestling. How important has that been in building you as a person? You just mentioned fighting corruption. There, you obviously have to fight many things when you're in politics. You have to face criticism. You have to face opposition. So as a sportsman, has it helped you build, let's say, an armor around you and also techniques in tackling these problems?
And to gain success or to be successful in the sports, you need to start early as a kid. And this age is from 13 to 15, which is early teenage years. So if you look back in your preteen years, it is a period which comes with a huge changes, and which one of the ways is to keep yourself busy, and those doors are sports and culture. So at this point, I appeal to the young people, especially the early teenagers, to get to know and to get acquainted with sports and culture. So the first thing that sport teaches you is patience and mentality to win, to your ambition to win. Patriotism, it instills patriotism. And also one of the important things is punctuality. Yes, sports requires you to be very punctual to the last minute and to the last second. Yes, therefore my fight against corruption, which is making Mongolia bad in the whole world, all these techniques and the things that I learned from being a sportsman is helping me throughout my battle. And I believe I will be able to win in this battle against corruption for, again, taking back into account those things that I just mentioned. On top of that, during the market economy, when I was in my 30s, I gained success in business, which gives me the immunity to be not to be sold out or to be corrupted. And before my visit to India, I met with the ambassador of India to Mongolia, and during that meeting, we have discussed about, and I introduced him to my plan of action during my presidential years. And one particular point was to develop isolated Mongolian towns. that sub-administrative sub is called SUM. These SUMs generally have population of 2,000 to 4,000 people only, and the isolated SUMs are from about 1,000 to 1,500 kilometers from this capital city, Ulaanbaatar. Mongolia has 330 SUMs. And with after during our talks, the Indian ambassador told me that India has over 500,000 sub-districts like SUMs, small.
Discounted SUM, small.
At that time, I realized, I thought that my headache is not as big as the Indian president's.
When you're developing the western part of the country, you're faced with a few problems. One is, of course, connectivity. So you want to build more roads. You, I believe, already have electrification in that area, but you're looking to do more electrification in that area. Are you looking at India now to perhaps move into that area, the western part, and do projects in that area? And are there any specific areas that you're looking to develop?
Minister for Infrastructure, Road and Development. So at that time, I came up with very ambitious proposals with my colleagues, which was to connect all the 21 provinces with the city, and the we asked finance from the ADB, Asian Development Bank. And today, at this point, we have completed over 5,000 kilometers of asphalt road, which is connecting whole 21 provinces to the capital city of Ulaanbaatar. At that time, I faced my team faced with very big opposition, saying that this is with that being the isolated province, Sums, it is there are not many people who are living there. And after completing these roads, it has brought many positive outcomes. Just for example, the domestic tourism has increased, and the international tourism who are going to the isolated parts have increased as well. Today, all of our SUMs have electricity at this moment, and it is a huge success. And herding families, they have solar panels for their household use. And I have heard and I have seen about the Indian isolated provinces and parts of India through media. But my solution to these, to develop these isolated parts, is to introduce, develop and progress the scientific and innovative development.
You just mentioned your biggest challenge today is fighting corruption. What else is on the agenda?
It is everywhere.
It is everywhere. And what else is on the agenda? So with fighting corruption, are you planning to also perhaps streamline the systems? For example, foreign investors coming into the country, would you be allowing them single window access? Would you be changing the regulations for, let's say, visas? Would you be doing something to try and make Mongolia more open to the world?
So the fighting corruption isn't a one single act. It has a very complex stages. And with these stages, for example, to create a model of bringing the foreign investment, attracting foreign investment, and with that, there are a number of steps to be followed. And for example, ministers of environment, that I'm saying ministers because I'm saying it's in the long back in the law, taking long period of time. So they, in name of the tourism, they have sold the land, which was illegal, which is still illegal. With these bad wrongdoings, prospering of business and inviting investors in the country is very challenging. But I believe that these problems aren't going to last forever.
President, thank you for sharing your views with us, and we wish you luck in fighting corruption.
Okay, thank you very much.